You're listening to Excess Gaming Podcast, a podcast for gamers by gamers, with your hosts Xander Skullion and James Gruesome, bringing you something old, something new, and a little bit of nostalgia too.
Hello everyone, and welcome to another episode of Excess Gaming Podcast. This is episode 84. We're recording this on April 24th. I'm one of your hosts, Xander Skullion, and unfortunately, James Gruesome will not be joining us this episode. He woke up, actually last night he like texted me at midnight and was like, dude, I'm like throwing up, I'm really, really sick. So he's resting right now, drinking some Coca-Cola, eating some bread, I hope. But this is going to be a really fun episode because I am joined by a very special guest, someone I've been wanting to get on this show for a very long time. I am joined by my good friend from Panama, Karcamo. What's up, man?
What's up, all you Karcamaniacs? This is Karcamo, the Forger of Pain, and I want to thank you all, and I want to thank especially Xander for inviting me in the show, and actually I'm a big fan of his channel and his podcast, so hey, thank you, man. I appreciate it.
Awesome, awesome. And if you guys are wondering, like, man, that was a really, really nice intro. Well, if you guys haven't been following Karcamo, not only is he an avid game collector and YouTuber, but he is also a professional wrestler. And I was like, wow, that's really cool. You know, growing up, you know, in North Carolina, you know, the has so much history of pro wrestling. I was like, man, that's really, really cool. So I'm going to ask you, Karcamo, a little bit about wrestling. Like, what made you be like, man, I want to be a pro wrestler?
Well, it all started when I was a little Karcamaniac. I was 4 years old, and the first, it's incredible, because the first wrestling match I ever saw in my life was Hulk Hogan versus Andre the Giant in WrestleMania 3.
Oh, wow.
And when I saw those guys larger than life, and then I saw Hulk Hogan pick up Andre the Giant, I'm like, man, those were like, for me, and as a kid, those were like the real life superheroes. And I really wanted to be like that. And there's something I always tell my fans, and well, not only my fans, my friends and co-workers that always ask my backstory, is that it's funny because I never actually changed a lot. I think I just acquired more grown-up responsibilities because I liked the same things when I was 4 years old. I love, I still love action figures. I love wrestling. I love gaming. I still love cartoons, anime. It's all since I was four, really. Like, if you knew me when I was a kid, like, hey, man, I haven't changed a lot. I just have a job and you know, bills to pay. But that was what started my fandom, my love for wrestling, was that single match.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's iconic right there. And when you were talking about toys, this reminded me that one of the things that really attracted me to your channel wasn't only the theatrics and the fact that you were a pro wrestler, and I'm like, that's pretty awesome, and he plays video games, but you also have probably the most interesting and most immersive unboxing videos. Now, unboxing videos are usually, in my opinion, I don't really watch a whole lot of them because some of them, not to sound bad or anything, but some of them are kind of boring. You know, they just open up the box, they look awkwardly at the camera, and they show every little nook and cranny, and sometimes that's cool, especially if the person has a really, you know, explosive personality. But every unboxing that you do, it's like you're on a journey, man. Like, my favorite was the latest one you did, the Tomb Raider, for the newest Tomb Raider game, and you climbed, what was it, the tallest volcano in Panama?
Yeah, the tallest summit in Panama. Yeah, it's a volcano, and it's funny because for all my life, I thought it was inactive, but now I found out that it's actually somewhat active.
Oh, gosh.
And I'm like, holy crap. Okay, we're nearly the end of times. This could blow up any second. So, it's the tallest summit here in Panama. It's actually the border of Panama with Costa Rica. Mm. And it was freaking hard, man. And for me, what I tell people, I'm a, everybody like, you're the forger of pain. You're a pro wrestler. That would have been easy for you. I'm like, dude, I've been wrestling for 10 years. For the most part, hardcore wrestling. Like, like you have to, like I say, like wrestling years are like doggy years. You should multiply that like for 2.5 or something. And really, I have like my right knee is like really bad. I busted up. I broke two of my ankles, and all you can see all those crazy stuff are in my channel. So the thing is that it took me 10 hours going up that, and I wasn't tired. It wasn't like I'm dying here. No, thank God I have good lungs, and I wasn't tired. I was like, you know, my feet and my knee were hurting. That's the thing. That's why I was like. I went up and I was in pain, but I did it. So it took me 10 hours and I had to, not only I had to climb with my sleeping bag, my water jugs, my food, you know, all the surviving kit. I had the tripod. I had the camera. I had the audio equipment. I had that freaking Tomb Raider figure.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So I had to do all those things to get up there, but you know, it was great. It was an awesome experience. I never, first time I did that. I want to do it next year again. But it was worth it. Really. I was really happy with the final product. Awesome. Final product being my video and not the collector's edition.
Now, Karcamo, I wanted to ask you, what was it that gave you the ideas of doing these unboxings? Because, like I said, they're very different. It's not your norm, you know, vlog type of unboxings that, like I said, they're so elaborate. Like, what gives you the ideas? Like, do you get the product and you're like, you get a brainstorm, or do you kind of brainstorm ideas that would accommodate for that style of, like, special edition or unboxing?
Well, the thing is that, to be honest, and I've never done a brainstorm. It just like pops in my head, and I'm like, oh, I'm gonna do it there. But you know, to start from the beginning, the thing is that actually I agree with you. I don't like unboxings, and when I started my channel, I'm like, I want to do things. It's not like I want to do things different and I want to be better than anybody else. No, I didn't. That's not at all what I thought. What I meant was that why don't I like unboxings? And then I thought, like, what would make me, like myself, watch an unboxing? And so that's why I started doing it like that. But I mean, it goes a little bit deeper. The thing is that. And I don't want to offend like nobody that's listening to the podcast or my viewers, my Karcamaniacs. When I do a video, for the most part, I try to please myself.
Oh yeah.
Like I do it for myself, and like I have to like it, I have to love it, and I have to have the idea that when I watch my own video, I like it so much. That I want to see it again. I don't know if you get my drift.
Yeah, that's what I always tell a lot of people that are starting out in YouTube and they ask for advice. I always say, make content that you would enjoy watching yourself. You know, it's got to be something that you're 100% comfortable with and that you enjoy. And overall, it makes a better product. Because if you like doing what you're doing, you're always going to do a better job. You know?
Yeah. And the other thing is that I understand, don't get me wrong, I understand the actual point of unboxings, the finality of them. It's you know, it's just like a fast content. I'm not going to say a throwaway content because it's not throwaway content. But it's something like really fast for the most part, like everybody does. And I'm not like. I'm not criticizing everybody, but I mean, that's my opinion. I don't like them, but everybody does them, you know, like really fast with their webcam or, you know, something like that. There's no like details with the camera or anything. And I mean, it's pretty quick. And for the most part also, like, I mean, unboxing is not a video like you want to watch over and over again.
Yeah.
For the most part. But like I said, I feel like I would be like betraying myself if I do that. And well, the thing is, so expand upon a little bit about your question and well, to end it, the other thing is that the first unboxing that I did, well, maybe not the first, one of the first that I did about a collector's edition was the order, what was it, 18 something.
1886,
you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you. I'm like, I know it's 18 something. Yeah, so that was the first one. And yeah, it wasn't a popular game, but still, you'll see that I'm on like on a black backdrop. It still was a lot of work put into that. So I did that, and I like that unboxing. It wasn't like at a weird location or anything, but I loved it. So the thing is that when I ordered my the Claptrap in a box, Borderlands, whatever edition, because it's a huge name. and I love Borderlands. I like, you know what? It would be cool if I do this in the desert, Sariwa in Panama, because, you know, it reminds me of Pandora. And I wanted to do it themed. So that's when the thing, like, actually started. So I did that in the desert with a friend. It was just me and a friend. Well, the thing is that it's actually a really funny story that I might do it someday in my channel, because it's a long story. A lot of shit happened after we did that unboxing. I had like a drone and everything, and I lost it because of the wind. Oh my god! It really.
Oh wow!
It was actually a disaster. And like to tell you a long story short, like 3 months later, I got a call. Like I kid you not. The drone wasn't even mine. It wasn't my friend's, but it had one of my GoPros. And 3 months later, I get a call like, "Hey, you're Karcamo, right?" I'm like, "Yeah." Like, "I think I found your drone." I'm like, "What?" And yeah, really. And the guy watched the video. Thank God he was an honest person, and he saw me, and he's like, "Oh, this is Karcamo." And he, I don't know, he got my number somehow. And he called me, and that's like a 5-hour drive from Panama, from the city. And I took a bus, and I went there. I picked up the drone, and the camera, and everything was perfect. I'm like, wow, I was lucky.
Yeah, really. And to kind of segue away from the question as well, I did want to mention one thing though, is that you know, there's so much going on YouTube, so many gaming channels, and so many people kind of follow this certain formula, and that is one thing that I will tell the listeners about your channel, and the reason why I like it so much is the fact that you're not afraid to try anything different, and, you know, and that can also go advice to people that want to start their own YouTube channel, or maybe they're in a slump. Maybe they feel kind of burnt out. And that's another thing with YouTubers. You get burnt out after a while following the same formula. Don't be scared to kind of experiment, you know, and that's something that you've always done on your channel, and that's something I really commend on that, because it could be anything from unboxings to Let's Plays to reviews. I mean, your Street Fighter review, you have, you know, the hand puppet, and
oh yeah,
yeah, it was
the pirate.
Yeah, it was great. I mean, it's always nice seeing someone think outside, being like, you know, well, I'm just going to do a pickups video. I like pickups videos, but I like hearing the reason why people like pickups, why they pick up their games. You know, it's not like a grocery list. You know, some people they just go over a game and they just throw it to the side. Like, tell me why you bought this game.
Yes,
you know?
To me, that my first pickup video, I was inspired by Kid Choryuken, the Thrift Dwellers. Mm-hmm. Well, there's a lot of people. I think Peter Doerr too. And there's a list that I did at the end of my first two pickup videos. Like, I just did like, okay, guys, this is because of you. And I put a list. And that's how, it's funny because that's how Kid Choryuken found me, my channel. He's like, I remember like one day in one of the comments in my video, he was like, okay, this is what happens when you search your own name on YouTube. And he found my thing. And it's incredible because we have come so close and we become great friends. But anyway, I digress. The thing is that Yeah, pickups. I love pickups videos because I like to hear that too. Like, I got this game, and sometimes there's like a cool story behind that.
Exactly.
Like, yeah, this stuff happened and this and that, and then like I bargain and then I went and I returned, and you know, it's sort of was a cool story behind how you got that game, and not only how you got it, because for me, for most part. You know, I'm from Panama, to remind the viewers, the listeners. So games are really expensive here in Panama, and for the most part, I always buy things through eBay. But still, even though I get most of my things on eBay, I still, like, I say, why did I get this? And, you know, I give a reason. Like, I really don't buy, like, games just for the hell of it. I mean, sometimes, of course, you see a good deal, and it might be a piece of crap, or you're a collector, and you have OCD, and you get the game. But for the most part, I always have like a good reason why I pick up that game. Sometimes, wrestling, it's been a little slow this year, but sometimes I get paid to go. For the most part, I wrestle in Florida, in the Opa-locka area, and Fort Lauderdale, and... Well, I get paid and I go there, and every time I'm over there, I try to stay. Like, shows are on Saturdays, sometimes Friday, but most of the time they're Saturdays, and are during the day. We do a lot of shows in the Opa-locka flea market. I wrestle with CCW, that's Coastal Championship Wrestling. And that's pretty awesome. They have like great people there. Sometimes they get like Gangrel.
Nice.
Yeah, sometimes it gets Sabu, Steven Richards, great workers. And the thing is that, well, yeah, they do that show on a flea market. It's the Opa-locka flea market. And, I mean, I'm like, well, I'm right there.
Dude, that is awesome.
Yeah, I know. Like, I'm right here. And I get, and then I get some games. And sometimes I go to the swap shop. Yes, the swap shop. It's like a big ass flea market. I go there on Sundays, and that's a little furthest from Opa-locka. I'm not really sure the place right now, but the thing is that I go there and I buy some games. And the other thing is that I've, like I said, man, I'm a big YouTuber, like a big fan, and I've been following people on YouTube since it started. And so I know, I don't live in the U.S., but I know all the tricks, like if I live there, because of so much videos that I've seen. And when I go on Sunday, I'm also, it's like 6 a.m., I'm already out in the flea market to get the good stuff. And well, sometimes I miss that. I think I might go on, I might wrestle in Florida, maybe on... Like after E3, like maybe in July, and I'm definitely going to the flea market to get some games.
So pretty much what you're saying, Karcamo, is you know the tricks and you know how to catch people slipping.
Yeah, actually,
pretty much. But yeah, man, talking about that, and you mentioned eBay. This is a story that you actually mentioned before we started recording, and we can kind of touch base on this, and that's about. Amazon Prime. Amazon is really trying to push their Prime membership, where they're making it where you can get games exclusively with certain deals just for Prime members. And what are your thoughts about that? Because I got some thoughts about Amazon Prime as well. But what'd you think about this?
Well, I think that's really shitty. You know, that's not that. Right way to lure people to your product, to your service, because yeah, I mean, it is shitty. Come on, let's say you want this game, and let's say, why not, let's say you buy on Amazon all the time, or you know, sometimes you buy on Amazon, but you do buy on Amazon and you're not a Prime member, but you still use their webpage, and oh look, you know, like, I want to buy the game. No, you can't, because you have to be a Prime member. I don't think it's fair. Now, I'm a Prime member myself. I've been using Amazon since, what, like 4 or 5 years? I can't remember. But I've always been a Prime member. And I got to tell you, I mean, I'm a collector. If this is the first time you know about me, but you're a gamer, you know how collectors can be, and you know, they're compulsive buyers.
Yeah, exactly.
And, yeah, and we have OCD and all that stuff, and we hoard and whatever you want to call it. So I do buy a hell lot of games, like really every single week. Like every single week I'm buying something. And I'm just going to tell you, I'm not getting paid by Amazon. I just want to make that clear. But I just want to tell you that really being a Prime member, it has its advantages. Like I said, if you're a collector and you like buying stuff a lot, you will save a lot of money. And I own a small TV production company in Panama. That's my major. I'm a TV producer. Been doing it for 15 years. And I buy a lot of equipment for my computers, like, you know, lenses and lights and stuff like that. And you'll save a lot of money also. Like, really, I'm not kidding. Like, sometimes you can save, buying something, you can save $100. And let me tell you something. Now, you know, we can see this way. You were saying, Xander, advising people that want to start on YouTube. Like, for example, I do a thing, I don't know if people are familiar with, something very small by Nintendo called Amiibos.
Oh, yeah.
Something insignificant. Oh, my God. English is not my first language, guys, so bear with me. The thing is that, can you say that for me, Xander?
Significant.
Well yeah, insignificant. That's easier. I was going to say insignificantly. Oh, damn it.
Okay. They catch what you're throwing, buddy.
Okay, thank you, guys. Okay, Amiibos. Nothing important at all. The thing is that I do something called Amiibo Hunts. And I used a GoPro because... Oh, sorry about that. I used a GoPro. God damn it, stupid pop-up. Okay, I used a GoPro. That's better. And so I go around, like, everywhere, you know, the shopping malls, the street, whatever. And it's really practical because, you know, it's small. So where I'm going at, I've seen other Amiibo hunts. And sometimes you're trying to hide your camera because, you know, it's a regular camera. It's kind of big. So where I'm going at is that I bought my thing on Amazon Prime, and it was pretty fucking cheap. And also, if you want to start your YouTube channel, you need some lights. I'm not talking about, like, professional equipment. I'm just talking, like some good lights. You could get them in Amazon Prime maybe for $100, $120, when for the most part they're, like, $150, sometimes $180, maybe $200. So I really, like, if you want to get into YouTube or do your I don't know, your things with video and stuff, I mean, Amazon Prime is a pretty good call to, you know, save some money. But still, I don't agree with their business model of, if you don't have Amazon Prime, you're fucked.
Yeah.
And I you know something, too? I don't get it either because it doesn't make any sense. I mean, for the most part, you can get that quote-unquote game in another web page or in another place. So I don't get it. I don't see them winning. Actually, I see them losing.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, when they force people to do certain things like this, it never ends well. And I've been an Amazon Prime member for a while now, and I enjoy it. You know, the pre-orders is really cool. You get 20% off. That really helps in case you're wanting to get, like, a special edition. I know I got a really good deal on some of the special editions, like the Street Fighter V and Mega Man collection that came out not so long ago.
Yeah.
I saved on a little bit of that. So, yeah, that, and of course, like you said, equipment for YouTube, you can save a little bit. But, you know, just to kind of, you know, take the consumer and kind of corner them and being like, yeah, you want this? Well, yeah, you can't get it off our normal membership. You had to be a Prime, and that's just going to make people say, you know, screw Amazon. I'm just going to go to Best Buy. I'm going to go to GameStop. I'm going to go to some other retailer. And now we got a lot of retail shops, auction shops, very similar to eBay, but they specialize in video games. Been hearing a lot about GameFlip. You know, a couple of YouTubers have been talking about that. And, you know, people are going to start going to GameFlip. They're going to, you know what, they're just going to flip off Amazon, no pun intended.
Yeah.
And they're going to go to GameFlip. So, I mean, I don't know.
Okay. pardon my ignorance, but what the hell is GameFly?
Well,
This is the first time I heard that before. This is the first time I hear that.
Yeah, GameFlip, it's very similar to eBay. You know, you can go and you can bid on items, you can buy items, and people sell games on there as well. And they do have promotions as well. Like if you buy a certain amount, you can get $5 off your next purchase. What's really interesting about it is, unlike some other auction sites that they've had in the past with video games, they usually change the currency, where you buy the currency from the website. Like maybe they have coins or tokens, so you can convert your currency to tokens to buy games off their website. GameFlip, though, they just use USD. They use standard American currency. So
great.
Yeah, it's a lot easier. So yeah.
Sounds awesome.
Yeah, definitely check out GameFlip. I know my friend Robert, your geeky tipster, he did a sponsored video on it, and also Sean Long from Retro Gaming Tube 85. He did a video on it as well. And yeah, the prizes are actually pretty good. They're not too bad. So definitely look into that, man. And also the listeners, look into GameFlip. I'm not sponsored, but I think it sounds great. It's a free plug right there. But we're gonna close the last two parts of the news before we get into Resident Evil talk. Now we're gonna be tackling something here. The PlayStation Neo, the upgradable PlayStation 4, is going to be hitting the shelves, I believe, in October, around the same time the VR is going to be hitting the shelves as well. And some people are asking, like, what is the PlayStation Neo? Which is kind of funny, because the VR codename was Morpheus, and this one's called Neo. So Sony has some little Matrix thing going on right now. But pretty much the PlayStation Neo is an upgradable PlayStation 4 console they're going to be selling. It's going to be a faster CPU. It's also going to be running 4K. The frame rate's going to be a lot better. I even heard that the bandwidth is going to be better, and the memory. And so far, the rumors are around the $400 price range that they're going to be selling it for. Now, when I first heard about this, Karcamo, I was pissed. It took everything of my power not to jump in front of the camera and rant about this, because I was just like, what the hell? You know, the PS4 is only 2 years old, and they're talking about and they're talking about this upgradable console. I'm like, what the hell? This is pretty much shitting on the early adopters. And, you know, for someone who hasn't bought a PS4 yet, this would be a great opportunity to do so. My main concern about the PS4 Neo, and luckily Sony is doing this the right way, is backwards capability. And what I mean by that is, if you get a PlayStation Neo, you're not just going to have to play PlayStation Neo games. And if you're using the basic PlayStation 4, you're still good. What they're pretty much treating this is that, you know, the PlayStation 4 is going to be your basic model, your core model. And then they're going to have the PlayStation 4 Neo that's going to be a little bit better that you can get as well. The best way to describe this would be kind of like how the 3DS is. You know, you got the 3DS, which is perfect. It's okay. But then you got the new 3DS, which I know a lot of people weren't happy with when it first got launched, but the new 3DS, you know, had a faster CPU, had updatable 3D technology. The 3D technology was good, and some games, you know, just play better on the new 3DS. And I think that's what they're kind of doing with the PS4. Now, are you going to be upgrading, Karcamo, when they do this?
I guess I will, so I can, like, tell my viewers, my subscribers about it, and, you know, give my own take. But, I mean, till now, it doesn't sound like a must-buy. Like you said, I mean, if you're, like, if you don't have a PS4, I mean, it's a great opportunity to jump in.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Go ahead. Okay. I thought it was gonna be actually yes, like the new 3DS, like there was gonna be games specially that you could only play them on the new PS4 Neo, but supposedly PlayStation and Sony are saying that no, Like, it's not going to be like that at all. If you buy a new game, you will be able to play it on the PS4, and you can play on the PS4 Neo. And what the Neo basically does is that, well, yeah, it runs faster. You know, it'll be a stronger system at some extent. And the games will look better. I mean, the new games will look better on the PS4 Neo.
Yeah, I mean, that's...
Okay, I'm sorry, I was just waiting for that car to play, but... Okay, so, yeah, sorry, let me continue. Yeah, the games will look better on the PS4 Neo, but it doesn't mean that the new games would only work on the PS4 Neo, and you have to game, like, you won't be able to play them on the PS4. So, I mean, in that aspect, that's cool, it's great, but I don't know. For me... Let's say, objectively, let's say I'm not a YouTuber. For me, like, so the only good thing they're trying to say is that it'll have better graphics and it'll run smoother, which is okay. I'm not complaining, but I need more than that in order to buy a new system or upgrade a new system because, you know, I've been a gamer, like, forever. I was born into gaming. So the thing is that like, for me, like, better graphics don't make a better game.
Yeah.
And I know, like, PC gamers always, I'm not also criticizing, they always trying to get the better rig to have, you know, the better graphics of the game. And really, that, and all to run it, you know, like, full speed ahead. And that's okay. But for me, really, that's not important. I was actually talking about with a friend, like, really, like, a couple of days ago, this thing, like, dude, he's like, no, my graphics and stuff like that. And I told him, look, there's, like, I'm not going to say hundreds, but I know there's a lot of games that I'd rather play on the NES than, and like newer games on the PS4 or the Xbox One. And I still look at those games, and they look amazing, and they're way funner. I don't know if you know what I mean.
Definitely. Also, I mean, like, of course, Xbox, there's some rumors that Xbox is doing the same route. They're going to be doing, they're doing prototypes right now of a possible Xbox 1.5. But, you know, it's funny you mentioned the PC gamers, because, you know, I can't believe there's still console wars and PC debates. I mean, I see it all the time on Facebook, and I'm like, man, we're like in our... Most of us now are like in our 30s, and we're still talking like we're, you know, in grade school in the playground. But, you know...
Yeah, I know.
But the thing is like, you know, you see the debates with the console gamers and PC, and they're like, this is better. No, this is better. One of the things that console gamers always use as their kind of like trump card was they would say... Oh, well, you know, at least when I get my console, I don't have to upgrade it, you know, in another 2 years. Well, that's what's happening now, and it's kind of funny because, you know, when the PlayStation 4 and Xbox came out, it was like a lot of people were like, man, we're getting more into, like, the PC realm with this all-inclusive console that does all these things, kind of very similar to a PC. So it's almost crazy how much it's kind of becoming this more of a hybrid, and... you know, the way I look at it, I don't have a 4K television, so that's another reason why I'm not, you know, getting too invested in the PlayStation 4 Neo. The only thing I will say is I'm pretty sure GameStop is going to be having some crazy trade-in deals if they're smart about it for people that do want to upgrade, you know, maybe trade in your PS4 and get a certain amount of store credit to go towards a PS4 Neo. That would be the best bet for them, for people that just want the newest tech. And that's pretty much what this is going to be for. It's going to be for the people that want the newest exclusive, the newest doodad to show off, for now anyway.
Yeah, and same thing happened to me, like you said. I'm more calm now, but I was kind of pissed because I'm like, really? Like, really? And you're like giving the middle finger to the people that bought the system, like maybe not on the first day, but on the first year.
Oh, yeah.
And then I was really pissed too. And I mean, the only cool thing they said about is that, you know, about the games, they're not gonna do like the new games are only for the PS4 Neo, but also you know, I mentioned this earlier behind the before we started recording, that I don't think, no, I'm sorry. Yeah, what I said is that I was afraid, and it's kind of happening right now. You mentioned that the Xbox One is thinking, and there's a rumor out there. I mean, just look it up. It's already out there that they're looking to do the same thing, like a new prototype ideas for an Xbox 1.5, if you will. And I saw, and I'm sorry if I'm going to do a plug or something. I watched, like, Review Tech USA, and he said something, Rich said something, like, I'm like, fuck, man, yeah, this could actually happen. He said, like, he was afraid that that now this is going to be a thing. Like, now, next gen is going to happen the same thing, and it's going to be a thing over and over again. Like, when the PS5 comes out, like, they'll do, like, this, you know, this console and stuff. And I said, like, in the middle of the life of the console, but, you know, it's not even the middle of the road. Yeah, you said it. It's only 2 years, and they're already pulling this shit. So now Xbox is going to do it. Now, what, Nintendo's going to do it, too? And, yeah, this is like a new thing. You know, this reminds me of the stuff, the shit that is happening with games nowadays. Like, and it happened a lot more last year, the quarter of last year. I don't know if you remember, Xander, mm-hmm. but, like, all the games that were coming out, they all needed, like, first-day patches.
Oh, yeah.
Like, they all had problems, like, Far Cry 4, Little Big Planet 3, what else came out, like, the holidays. Like, all games, really, like, Xbox One and PlayStation 4, they all needed, like, patches. Oh, yeah, I think it was Assassin's Creed Unity.
Oh, yeah, that was the famous one.
Yes, and, like, I was like, oh, man, really? Like, because of the new technology of DLC and patches and all that, like, let's just rush out a game, and it's not like a one thing of one company. Like, it was happening, like, on a daily basis, different developers, and I'm like, really, I'm comparing this to that, because, like, they can totally do that now. They have now the excuse, like, oh, come on, let's rush this console. We need the money, we need the sales, and, oh, it's okay, man. 2 years from now, we'll make it better. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, it's really interesting because, you know, when a new console comes out, it usually doesn't, I mean, it has a couple launch titles that people really enjoy, but the ball doesn't start rolling until the first 2 years that the console's coming out. Like, you know, I bought my PS4 last year, and by the time I bought my PS4, that's when I was like, man, PS4 is starting to come out with some good games. I saw E3, and I'm like, man, this is starting to get kind of good. So, you know, I will say, if you don't have a PS4, and if you have a 4K television, if you want to, you know, get the PlayStation 4 Neo. If not, the core PS4 now, it's going to be a lot cheaper. It's got to be cheaper by the time this new update comes out. They got to drop the price a little bit. So, you know, in all, it could have been really bad, and it's still, you know, nothing official. Nothing has really been come to surface. We'll see more of that, I'm sure, at E3. But for now, it's not as bad as when they first announced it. You know, when they first announced it, I was like, oh my god, this is not going to be good. And hopefully, fingers crossed, Sony's smart about this, because if they're not, this could possibly be something really, really bad. I mean, this could be like the Sega with the 32X and the Sega CD add-on. I mean, a lot of people, when they see a gaming console start to fail, they're always like, oh, they're pulling a Sega. But what that really means is, one of the problems with Sega, and one of the problems that they had that kind of made their downfall, was the fact they were putting out way too much hardware for the consumer to consume. And, yes. You know, with Sony having the VR coming out, that's going to be, you know, people are just going to have to, you know, want to get that. And also now the PS4 Neo. So we're looking at, you know, three pieces of hardware that Sony's going to be shoveling down for the holiday. And hopefully, you know, they do it right. Fingers crossed. Because I love to see consoles, you know, do well. I feel like the more consoles we have, the more choices we have as a consumer. Yes. And it's more competitive, which means more, you know, intriguing stuff to get. You know, if you only have one console, it starts to become a monopoly, and it's not fun anymore. So best of luck to Sony, and best of luck to Xbox. You know, if they start jumping this as well, it's hopefully it's all up from here, you know?
Yeah, I hope so too, man. I was really sad when Sega kicked the bucket. I wasn't like happy, like, yay. No, man, that's not good for us. And I hope, like, I agree, man. I hope like PlayStation and Nintendo and Xbox, they still, you know, up their game and you know, still stay as a business. And why not, man? It would be cool if we could have like another console. I mean, it wouldn't be good for my pocket, but but still.
Yeah, definitely. Now, what we're going to do, guys, is we're going to take a little break. But before we take our break, I am going to plug a Kickstarter, and I don't do this often, but I'm doing this because one of the guys that's working on this game, he's actually the composer, Jason Heine from All Gen Gamers Podcast, and also Heine House Records and Productions on YouTube. I'll have a link on his YouTube channel below, and also if you guys haven't checked out the All Gen Gamers, I mean, it's one of my favorite gaming podcasts, and they started putting out more episodes. That podcast really inspired XS Gaming Podcast, but he's working on a new game called Apex Racing, and this is going to be a 90s inspired racing game complete with polygon goodness, and they're running their Kickstarter right now. I believe they just got the green light from Steam, so everything's going really well right now. But what I'm going to do is, while we take our break, I'm actually going to play a song from the soundtrack so you guys can listen to it. And you know, while you're listening to it, click on the Kickstarter, check it out, and when we come back, we're going to be talking about Resident Evil, which this month turned 20 years old. So I was like, man, this would be a great time to mention it. And plus, Karcamo, you're a huge Resident Evil fan, so this is going to be really, really fun.
Awesome, man. Let's do it.
Alright guys, we'll sit back, relax, and we'll be right back. We'll be right back. All right, so we are back, guys, and that is Racing Apex. That was a song from the game, and again, I will leave a link to the Kickstarter on the description below so you guys can check that out and support the developers of that game and also support our good friend Jason Heine. And yeah, so we're going to be getting into Resident Evil talk, and isn't it hard to believe, Karcamo, that it's been 20 years of Resident Evil goodness?
I feel freaking old, man. That's all I can say. But I freaking love Resident Evil, so keep them coming.
Yeah, so I'm going to ask you, Karcamo, what would be your favorite Resident Evil game?
Well, it's kind of hard because my heart's divided because I love freaking Resident Evil, the original. I love it. And I also love Resident Evil 2. I don't know. Most people say like Resident Evil 4, but nah, man, for me, the originals is 1 and 2. I'm going to say 1. I love the original. I love the eeriness of the mansion that you really feel alone. I think it's a perfect balance between like survival horror and action. You know, you have like a little bit of both. And like the story, the way how you progress it, I think it's awesome. And for me, like the best remake of a game ever, it has to be like Resident Evil on the GameCube. That's now, you know, it's being remastered on the PlayStation 3 and PS4.
Yeah, I have to agree with that as well. When I first played the very first Resident Evil, I mean, it was just such a life-changing experience with games because, I'll be honest, when I first played Resident Evil, I didn't understand it. Like, I played it like I would play, you know, Zombies Ate My Neighbors.
What the hell is this?
Yeah, I went to every room and I killed every zombie. And then I had no ammo, and I'm like, well, where do I go from here? And I didn't understand it until actually me and my sister played it. Like, she would watch me, and I would play, and she'd, like, give suggestions. And we realized that it had a lot of puzzle aspects to it. And yes. I was like, wow. You know, I ended up picking up items, and I'm like, oh, this is a ruby. Oh, I gotta put this in a tiger's eye. You know, and that's when the game really started clicking for me. And I agree, man. Resident Evil 1, when you're inside that mansion, you do have that sense of, you know, being alone, and it's just you, and that's it. And you're trying to find out what happened to your other comrades in the STARS unit. And, man, that game was just something else. And I think you can agree with me, man. That one point when you're going in the hallway and that dog busts out of the window, holy shit. That was just something else, man. And, you know, the one thing that I hated about Resident Evil 1, like the one enemy that always got on my nerves, wasn't the dogs, wasn't the zombies or the hunters, even though the hunters scared the shit out of me, was the crows. Oh my god. Those crows were something else. And the best way, of course, to defeat the crows is with the knife. Out of all things, the knife is just the best way to do it. But
I never kill them, man. I just run away. Yeah, I never kill those freaking crows, man. I didn't even know the best weapon was the knife.
Yeah, I mean, I ended up having to kill them because of that one puzzle. And I believe it's a puzzle for the director's cut where you're looking at the paintings. And you're in that little studio hallway. And you're looking at, you have to look at every painting in a certain order. I think it's aging man or some shit.
Yes, that's right. But I don't know. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the crows, they only like, they go medieval on your ass when you finish the puzzle, right?
Yeah.
Well, when I finish the puzzle, I just run away. I'm like, I'm done. Goodbye. And I you know, go through the door and that's it. So I don't know. Why do you kill them? You don't have to kill them.
I just kill them with my knife. Like, leave the crows alone.
Yeah, I know, man.
But yeah, and of course, you know, you had, you know, Resident Evil 2, and I have a funny story of Resident Evil 2. My copy of Resident Evil 2 is actually that's in my collection. It's not my copy of Resident Evil 2. I think I mentioned this in a video. I think I made a video about, you know, borrowing and trading games. Well, I actually borrowed a copy of Resident Evil 2 from a friend of mine when I was, like, in middle school. This is when I was, like, you know, 13 years old, and he ended up moving away, and we never got to trade our games back. So he's got, I think he's got my copy of Twisted Metal 2, and I still have his copy of Resident Evil 2. But, oh, man, Resident Evil 2 was just something else. I mean, I love the atmosphere when you first start out here in the streets. It really made me think of, like, a George Romero zombie film. It was just so apocalyptic, and, you know, zombies were on fire coming out of cars going after you. And
Awesome.
And, of course, you know, getting to that point where you go to the save room and you hear that piano music, and it was just so therapeutic because you knew that you were safe. You knew you were okay once you heard that save music, but... But yeah, that was really fun. Was there a Resident Evil game though that you didn't care for?
Well, yeah, Resident Evil 6, man, that game sucked.
No, I want to ask you, because I didn't like Resident Evil 6 as much as well, and that was probably my least favorite in the numbered series.
Yeah.
What was it that made that kind of turned you off of Resident Evil 6?
Well, it might sound weird because it's more focused on action, but I found that game so freaking boring. I was bored playing Resident Evil 6, and I started playing there's actually a campaign. I got so bored, and I got so, no, not mad, I got bored, that there's a campaign that I haven't finished. I started with the Leon campaign, then they were saying that it was like a survival horror campaign, which it wasn't.
Yeah.
But I gotta say, it was the better one. And so there was this thing that I was complaining about the whole campaign, that it was too dark. And when I say dark, I don't mean like in an artsy kind of way. No, it was literally dark. Like there were some like places I used the I turned my brightness maxed on my TV. And, like, even the darkest part, no, they were, like, literally black. They would just go gray. And, like, I thought it was me. Like, I can't see. And really, I don't know. I was complaining a lot about that. And the story also, it was, I mean, it's Resident Evil. To some extent, it's kind of campy and stuff. And I know the story. Sometimes it doesn't make sense. So... it's going to sound weird for me to say this, but for a Resident Evil game, the story was really stupid.
Yeah.
And we've seen transformations in the Resident Evil that doesn't make sense, but there's a guy, and spoilers, but I'm not spoiling anything, that game sucks. There's a guy that transforms into a T-Rex.
Oh, geez. See, I didn't make it that far.
Oh, my God. Dude, there's that, like, this guy... And is he? He's in Leon's campaign. Yeah, I think he's in Leon's campaign. Like the main villain. That guy reminded me of the villain. I don't know if you saw The Last Action Hero with Arnie.
Oh yeah.
Well, remember that Benedict guy that had like a glass eye? That the villain. I don't know if you remember. Well, anyway, the villain here. It looks like that guy, and it reminded me a lot. That threw me off. But anyway, so this guy, you know, it's Resident Evil. This guy keeps coming back and back, and he has more transformations than Frieza from Dragon Ball Z. Yeah, I kid you not. And every time he comes back, he has a different transformation. And one of them, the guy transforms into a T-Rex.
Oh my God!
And I'm like, oh my God, these viruses keeps getting more ridiculous and more ridiculous. And you're there fighting a T-Rex with your gun and your shotgun, and we're like, oh my God, is this really happening? And still, then I played the other campaign that I think it's like spoilers again. You use like Cheryl Birkin from the daughter of the scientist of Resident Evil 2, mm-hmm. and the guy that invented the G virus,
and you use like Wesker's son. I don't know when did he had a son, but anyway, you use him, and it's also, man, oh my God. And then I started playing the Chris's campaign, Chris Redfield's campaign, and I felt that I was playing Call of Duty. I kid you not. I'm like, what is this? And then that's the thing when I turned off my console, and I'm like, I can't do this. And the other thing is that, for the most part, I've heard a lot, people hated Resident Evil 5. You know something? I enjoy Resident Evil 5 because I know it doesn't look like Resident Evil. I know it's an action game, but I played Resident Evil 5 co-op, and I had so much fun, really. I had so much fun playing that game, and I kid you not, I beaten that game like 3 times because the first time I played it was with an ex-girlfriend, and we beat it. Then I played it with my best friend, and we beat it. And then I played it with another friend, and I beat it again. And really, like, every time, it was really, it's so much fun, like, killing people with your friends and co-op. And that's the other thing. Like, you're going to hear a lot from me when I say that I'm an old-school guy, because I am. And I don't enjoy online gaming because, you know, I don't know, I think it sucks the fun. It's cool when having an actual person sitting next to you. Yeah. And all the time that I've told you this, that I've beaten the game 3 times, it's been with an actual person sitting next to me, and it's so much fun. So anyway, when I played Resident Evil 6, I saw that it had a big backlash. But of course, I'm a Resident Evil fan, and I'm a collector, so I had to have it. I had to have it. So what did I do? I called my best friend, like, hey, have Resident Evil 6. Let's play this. It was like, oh, man, let's do it. He was so excited because we finished Resident Evil 5, and we had so much fun. We're like, what? I know this is going to be it's gonna be crap on the Resident Evil mythos and everything, but it's a game. And, you know, sometimes you just have to kick back and have fun. So that was the plan. And still, man, it was so hard to get through those campaigns. Like in Resident Evil 5, we could play for hours and hours and hours that we like, hey, dude, we really have to stop playing. We have shit to do. We're grown-ups. And I have to sleep. I have to work tomorrow. You know, stuff like that. With Resident Evil 6, it was like we were playing the campaign and we're like, oh, my God. When is this chapter going to be over? We just wanted the chapters go by like really quick because we were so bored.
Oh, wow.
And it had its moments, but for the most part, for me, it was really boring. It was really boring.
Well, it's funny you mentioned Resident Evil 5 because I actually liked Resident Evil 5. I mean, I know that's one of them that people are like, ugh. You know, but...
Yeah, I know, right?
I really like it.
I like it too. I want to like play it again with a friend.
Yeah, I mean, I really enjoyed it. Resident Evil 4, when Resident Evil 4 came out, it was a game changer. And I really enjoyed Resident Evil 4. I played the hell out of it. And I felt like it took a lot of elements from Resident Evil 4 and just upped the ante with Resident Evil 5. And I was like, this isn't too bad. I mean, of course, you didn't have as many of the puzzles and stuff. It was more action. But it still had that Resident Evil flair to it. Where Resident Evil 6, I felt like they were trying to make 4 games into one. Slap Resident Evil on it. And
yeah, that's right.
Yeah, because, you know, you play Leon's campaign in Resident Evil 6. And it feels like you're playing Resident Evil 4 or 5. It doesn't feel as good. But it's like, huh, this isn't too bad. But, yeah, when you go to those later campaigns, and you were mentioning the Chris Redfield campaign, it does feel like, you know, like a dude bro game. I feel like I'm playing, like, Gears of War or something like that.
Yeah.
And it just did not feel as Resident Evil-ish. Now, I want to ask you this, because I played the first one. I haven't played the second one. And I wanted to hear your opinions. Have you played any of the Resident Evil Revelation games?
I actually just played the first one. I also, I have a backlog of Resident Evil games to play. And I liked the first one, too. Like, really, it was bringing back the classic survival horror. But I haven't played the second one. I've been meaning to play it. I've been meaning to play, like, a lot of games for a long time now. the other thing is that, I don't know if I'm getting a little off topic here, but Resident Evil, just like they announced the Umbrella Corps, right?
Oh, something yeah, like that. Yeah.
So there's the thing. I'm a sucker for Resident Evil, And I always get, and I love imports. Well, we haven't talked about that, but I'm sure we'll talk about it soon enough in the podcast. I love imports, and Japan, the cool thing about Japan is that they always release, like, exclusive collector's edition for their market that they don't release for the Western audiences, maybe because, I don't know, they won't sell, I don't know. So I always get them. Like, I have the collector's edition for Resident Evil Revelations 1. I have the collector's edition for Resident Evil Revelations 2. It's even like Resident Evil HD, remastered, whatever, got a collector's edition. And I've been meaning to do, like, unboxings for those. But it's going to be, like, quick unboxings because, you know, they're actually, like, really, they don't bring too many stuff. But anyway, I digress. The thing is that Umbrella Corps, this is a new game, and they announced, like, it's already available for pre-orders, a collector's edition. And I'm like, I saw that, and really, I buy, like, everything Resident Evil with the name on. With the name Resident Evil, I buy it, and I saw the collector's edition. I'm like, oh my god, it's really a bad collector's edition. Like, it has a T-shirt that it has like it's all plain black T-shirt, and it has like a small logo on a shoulder of Umbrella. And I'm like, man, like, you could get that done like anywhere.
Yeah, really.
That's like a crappy thing. Then I saw it has like I don't know if you've seen like paintball or airsoft, but those masks that are like cloth type that you cover like from your nose down and has like a little face.
Yeah.
It has one like that and it looks so generic. And then I'm like, oh my god, it has a DLC that obviously I won't be able to use. I mean, if I join the PSN Plus Japan, I will, but nah, it's okay. So it has that and some other thing that I can't remember right now, but it was so crappy that, like, even me, that I buy, like I said, I buy anything. If there's a piece of shit and it says Resident Evil, I'll buy it. I'm like, I'm not going to buy that.
Well, the fact that you said that you can't remember it shows how bad it is.
Yes, and that's the thing that that's why I said if I'm getting a little off topic because, you know, I'm getting into Capcom territory now. But that's the thing, I'm really disappointed with Capcom. Like, I don't get it, man. These guys have everything to make great, you know, make good money. And I don't know if they're not interested in money anymore. They're burned out. I don't know, but it seems like they're not even like. They're not even trying. That's what I wanted to say. That I think they're just going, not on a limp, they're like an autopilot, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, I was just about to say, they're just going with the motions. Because, yeah, I mean, Capcom has so many great IPs. I mean, the big thing that people always talk about, Street Fighter, Mega Man, Resident Evil, but I mean, they have other stuff like Strider, which I mean,
Rival Schools, man, where the fuck is Rival Schools?
Oh my gosh, man, Project Justice on the Dreamcast.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. I mean, Capcom to me, like Capcom, they really hit their peak around the like PS2 Dreamcast era.
They did. They were freaking like everywhere, and every single game was gold, man. Plasma Sword, also known as Star Gladiator. So sorry. Now, let me repeat that again for the motorcycle.
That's all okay. Good.
Yeah. Plasma Sword, also known as Star Gladiator. They also had because they're not doing anything with it, Power Stone. Power Stone was freaking amazing. God.
Okay, yeah, I'm glad you mentioned Power Stone because that's a game I always mention when I get on the subject about what kind of games would you like to see a sequel. I mean, dude, imagine a Power Stone 3 game with online, you know, multiplayer. I mean, a lot of people love Smash Brothers, but
I love Smash Bros. But you know what I say? I'm like, fuck Smash, man. Power Stone. Why nobody talks about Power Stone?
And you wouldn't have Smash Brothers, in my opinion, if it wasn't for Power Stone. Power Stone was that party fighting game that we just grew up with, and I loved it. I mean, I have it on the Dreamcast. I had the collection on PSP that comes of Part 1 and Part 2. And I mean, yeah, I would love to see a Part 3. Power Stone. That would just be, oh my gosh. And also another one that a lot of people don't talk about is Fighting Vipers.
Yes. Well, Fighting Vipers. I totally forgot that was Capcom, but that was an awesome game. The guys with the rollerblades and the skates and the guitars. Man, you can't get more cool than that, man.
Yeah, I mean, it's a shame. It's more of a shame than anything else that Capcom's just, you know, they're sitting on gold. And like you said, man, it's almost like they don't like money anymore. And maybe it is their own autopilot. Maybe they're just going with the motions. Maybe they feel like the market's changed so much that they're kind of scared to make risk, you know, because it seems like the only things they're really going after is, you know, Street Fighter. I would say Mega Man, but, I mean, other than the collections that we get and the endless merchandise, there's plenty of merchandise for Mega Man. There's nothing new. But, you know, at least I can say one thing. Capcom isn't Konami yet. And the reason why I'm saying that with Konami is because, you know, Konami to me was dropping the ball way before this whole, like, focusing on mobile and pachinko machines.
Oh, yeah, I know. They were dropping the ball, like, years ago.
Yeah, and the reason why I say that is because when you talk to people about Konami now, and I saw it recently on a Facebook post, and this is what gave me the idea, was when people talk about Konami, they talk about Metal Gear Solid and Silent Hill. And, you know, I love Silent Hill, I love Metal Gear Solid. But, you know, what about Castlevania? You know,
what about Contra? What about Contra?
Yeah. Well, actually, Contra, they are releasing a new Contra game, but it's a mobile game.
Oh, fuck that, man. And
here's the thing, too, man, is the mobile game looks amazing. Like, I was watching it, I'm like, man, this looks great, but I don't want to play it on my mobile device. Like,
of course not.
You know, you don't play Contra with a controller. You can't feel buttons. You know?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Doesn't feel right. Or I don't know, at least launch it for the 3DS. I don't know.
Oh, man. Yeah. I mean, I just don't get it. But
yeah, and I remember Konami was like the granddaddy of beat 'em ups, man. They did freaking Turtles in Time. They did The Simpsons, X-Men. And what about RPGs, man? Konami did Vandal Hearts, Suikoden. Man, Konami was on the top of their game, man.
Yeah, and I don't know. I think, like I said with Capcom, I felt like Capcom hit their peak with the PS2 and Xbox era. I think Konami themselves kind of hit that peak at, you know, almost like towards the end of the PlayStation 1 lifespan.
Yes, but, because, you know, I was doing I did that video, I mean, I'm going to edit it this week. I'm real late on the tag videos because I get tagged on the videos. I'm like, oh my God, I got to do this video. So I did, like, most nostalgic games. And I realized at the end of the thing, like, oh my God, like, most of the nostalgic games that I loved were Konami.
Yeah.
It was between Capcom and Konami.
I cold heartedly agree with that, man. I really agree with it because, Capcom and Konami were just powerhouses. I mean, even if you go back to the NES days when Konami had their second developers, the Ultra Games. I mean, Ultra Games was pretty much Konami as well. And so many great games. But unfortunately, you know, there's just relics of the past, and hopefully, I mean, going back to Resident Evil, because we start talking about Konami and Capcom.
We drifted. But yeah, it's so hard to talk about, like, Capcom without mentioning Konami. Yeah, it's kind of hard.
It is. I mean, this is the best way to describe it. It's like Konami and Capcom was like the Burger King and McDonald's of video games.
that's a great comparison.
You know, going back to Resident Evil, you know, there's still rumors of, you know, a Resident Evil 7, and of course the Resident Evil 2 remake that we're supposed to be getting.
We haven't seen anything about it, but yes, I'm kind of excited. I don't know which route they're gonna go. I wish they did it with the GameCube remake, because, I don't know, I can't imagine, but that's just me. Like I said, I'm an old guy. I can't imagine Resident Evil 2 without tank controls.
Yeah, which it was funny because my co-host, James, like, for the longest time, he hated tank controls. But it just, and I admit, I've went back and played some of the games, and I'm like, oh man, these tank controls are really weird, but it doesn't take long. It's like riding a bike, you just don't forget.
Yeah. Now, for me, I don't know. Okay, I gotta admit, tank controls, if you're like a new gamer and you never played Resident Evil 1, Resident Evil 2, 3, Code Veronica, or you never played Silent Hill 1, 2, 3, 4, if you never played any of those games, you'll feel really weird. Because, you know, something I still remember, like it was yesterday, the first time I took the PlayStation controller and I started to play Resident Evil 1. I was really confused with tank controls.
Oh yeah.
But I got used to it, and to be honest, Xander, I could play Resident Evil or any of those games right now, and for me it wouldn't even feel weird. It would feel like, I don't know, an extension of my body. It feels so right. And because, you know, I grew up with that. It's like part of my system. It's my brain. It's implanted in my brain. And but yeah, I know, I mean, I understand, obviously I can't like be all like closed-minded, like, no, it has to be this way, kids, you don't know what you're talking about. No, I know I'm almost sure it's not going to be tank controls, because, you know, a lot of gamers nowadays, especially the millennials, won't get like, no, they can't, you know, like rub the wrong way, like, no, I'm not going to play that, it feels weird. So I get that. But whatever it is they're doing, I just hope that they don't go like the action-based route. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I hope they don't do that.
Yeah, I agree with that. And before we get into games we've been playing recently to wrap up the show, because we're running short on time, I did want to mention one thing, and that was you brought up a good point talking about the tank controls and you know, remakes and stuff like that. And this is how I look at remakes. You know, I feel like remakes should offer something new for the old school fans like us, and not just,
yeah,
you know, not just graphics. Even though that's fine. You know, if they were to make Resident Evil 2 and just give it the same engine as the remake on GameCube and the HD remake on PS4, I would be happy, and I'm sure you would be happy too.
I would be so freaking happy, trust me.
But you know, if they wanted to add a little bit more to it, that's cool and stuff like that. But at the same time, it's like you can't change too much. But yeah, you don't want to make it just a carbon copy, because if it was a carbon copy, it'd be like, I don't even know why I would want to buy this. Like, to me, I would just be buying it because I'm a fan, or maybe just to, you know, support future endeavors of the series. So I do hope they keep that core. They keep the roots, I should say, of Resident Evil 2. And, you know, if they don't use tank controls, make the controls where it's just a nice even ground. Almost like Resident Evil 4, Resident Evil 5 controls. Just make it like that. But don't go Resident Evil 6 route and have, you know, Leon or Ada Wong taking cover from William Birkin and like going around the corner and shooting something with your M16. Don't do that. Just don't.
Yeah, please don't.
Or have like the cop zombies start pulling out their 9mm and start using them. Oh my god. That was just,
God, please.
I hated that. But yeah, let's get into the last little leg of the show and talk about games we've been playing recently. And I'm going to pass it over to you, Karcamo. What have you been playing recently? I know you're a busy guy, but have you gotten your game on?
Yeah, actually, this year it's been kind of tough. There's a lot of things going on here in my country, and I do a lot of things. I mean, as Karcamo and as my Clark Kent persona. So... Yeah, this year I've been limping to play some games. So, but yeah, I played some games for the first time, and I've been enjoying them. I played and beat Rayman Origins. Love that game.
Oh, nice.
Then on the PS3. Then on the PS4, I played Rayman Legends, and I gotta say, man, that platform game, it's like I can't recommend it enough. It's so much fun. They try new things that I never seen before. Like my favorites are like the music levels. So there's this. Have you played Rayman Legends before?
I haven't, actually. So enlighten me.
You have to, man. You owe it to yourself. I swear to God, if you love platformers, you have to play Rayman Legends. And I recommend, like, really, you don't have to play Rayman Origins first. You can play Rayman Legends. Yeah, I mean, it's even better. The thing is that, okay, imagine there's this side-scrolling level that it keeps, like, side-scrolling, you know, like if you were on a treadmill, let's say it that way. Those levels that keep going on and you have to, you know, you have to run. And behind you, there's like a, look, you know, if the screen catches you, you'll die. So this level, music level, it has like a music cover of, and they have like awesome, great rocking tunes, man. Right now, I can't freaking remember, but just to put an example, let's say they have like We Will Rock You from Queen. And the thing is, like, you know, it's in the background. It's a cover. It's not like the original one, but still it's pretty cool. And like with the beats of the music, you have to, and your reflexes, you have to like jump, you have to duck. You know, it's like, I'm going to put it this way. Have you played 8-bit Runner?
Yeah, that's a good game.
Well, it's kind of like 8-bit Runner, but it's kind of like 8-bit Runner, but only, I don't know, it's cooler, really. So you go like jumping and going through loops, like, yes, like Sonic, and you have to kill your enemies, and then, you know, duck and then jump. But all this and the graphics are like hand drawn, and they are beautiful, like the colors, they pop out. Like I said, the music, and that's like my favorite thing. Like, as you can see, I'm really excited. I love Rayman Legends. You have to play it, man. It's an awesome game. I recommend it to everybody. The other thing is that it's a PS4 game. It's also on the PS3, and you can get like for $15. For $15 new. I guess in GameStop or I don't know, in eBay or anything, it has to be a lot cheaper. So I recommend it. So yeah, finish Rayman Origins, Rayman Legends. Right now, I just finished Captain Toad Tracker. I had a lot of fun playing that game. It was really hard to put the controller down. Like the puzzles are really embedded. I really like every time I play a Nintendo game. No, that's but it's, you know, not being fucking up that much. It's Nintendo. And when they do a game, I'm always wondering, what are these guys smoking, man? Yeah, because really, like, the creativity of the level designs and the creature or monster design, whatever you want to call it, the puzzles, like, everything. I'm like, I play that game, and I kept saying to myself a lot of times, like, wow, man, these guys are really smart. And whatever they're smoking, I need some of those.
they do come up with like this crazy little factory of ideas, man. I played a little bit of Toad Treasure Tracker before, and yeah, it's very addicting. And it's pretty interesting about the fact you can't jump and you're playing it in 3D certain ways. But myself, I've been playing actually, before we started recording, and I have it paused right now because I'm at an area that I couldn't just stop playing. I'm playing Star Fox Zero on the Wii U. And
yes, I have to get that. But I actually, yesterday I was in the mall with my girlfriend, and we were like, you know, we were just like window shopping and stuff, and they were promoting Star Fox Zero. But when I go to the mall, I go into every single gaming store. Even though I know what they have, I still go in. And so the thing is that they were promoting the game, and I played it for a bit. I was a little confused at first with the controls. I have to get used to it. But then I played it like 5 minutes. I was like really, really confused. After a time, I felt like, I don't know, I feel like right at home. Like I was playing Star Fox on the SNES. And it felt great, and it looked great, and really, it felt like Star Fox. And but yeah, I have to get that game like later because I don't have time to play right now.
Yeah, that's something I did want to touch base on, is the controls, because I did a Let's Play of it that I uploaded last night, and you know, it was funny because, you know, Nintendo didn't really explain too much about the fact that you can turn off the motion controls. You don't have to play it with the motion controls. You can play it like a classic.
Thank God.
Yeah, you can play it like a classic Star Fox game. And it was funny because I mentioned it in a Facebook post when I was doing the Let's Play, I was like, hey guys, just one thing I wanted to mention is Star Fox, you can turn off motion controls. And Aaron from Retro Liberty was like, oh my gosh, really? And I'm like, yeah. He was like, dude, you gotta make a video about this. Because I had sent him a private message of the video and be like, this is how you turn off motion controls. He was like, dude, make a video of it. So I did, and it blew up. For my channel, it blew up. You know, and a lot of people were just like, oh my god, thank you. Because Nintendo was very, very, they just weren't open about it. But apparently, you know, when you look at the touch screen, in the right corner, you can actually turn off the motion controls, and it really makes the game a lot better. But I will say, even with the motion controls off, I had to get used to the controls. I mean, I didn't really play that well when I first played, when I did my Let's Play. My playing wasn't that great, but it's because I was doing my Let's Play as a first impression.
Okay.
You know? So I was like, you know, I've explained in the video, I'm like, hey guys, I'm pretty much playing this for the first time as well. So I thought it would be a really interesting video. But, you know, now I'm at stage 4 and I'm starting to get used to the other vehicles, because you don't just use the air wing. You also use, like, your air wing turns into, like, a land type of thing. And it looks like a chicken they can run around with. How do you guys say that?
I know. I did a video when I went last year to E3. I did a video about that. I'll post you a link so you can check it out. And that's what I said. Like, it looks like a chicken, and I used a song. There's this classic song, like, dun, 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 you know, that, like, the farm song. I use that song. And, it's looking like a freaking chicken. I'm like, what the hell?
Yeah, so you control the chicken. You also control this other... this other plane, and it's more of a plane. It's not so much of an air wing, because it's got two of the top propellers, and you control that, and you actually can drop this little robot down, and it's a robot. You control the robot, which is really hard to do. I'm still trying to get used to controlling the robot, because it can also get hit too. It doesn't have a defensive thing to it, but it's mostly there to hack computers. So, you know, you drop the little robot down, you control the little robot, and then you can look down your gamepad, and you can see through the robot's eyes if you want to do it that way. Or you can just hit the minus button on the Wii pad and have it on your TV. Because I will say as well, just like every other Wii U game, especially first-party Wii U games, and I think you can agree with this, Karcamo, a lot of people, they get kind of steered away from the Wii U because they just see the gamepad, and they're like, I don't really want to use the gamepad. Well, you can use the gamepad on Star Fox, but you can also use the Pro Controller and actually...
Oh, that's awesome.
And you can also use the Wiimote and the Nunchuck Controller as well. So you have a wide array of different styles that you can play this game, which I really like that. But I've been playing it mostly with the gamepad. And, of course, it came with Star Fox Guard, which I haven't played yet, so I can't really talk about it too much. I mean, other than... It was kind of like a... It was originally a tech demo from E3 of last year, what was like, you know, you controlled this little robot and you went through these little areas and you looked at the controller. It's kind of like the camera, almost like Five Nights at Freddy's kind of thing. But
I didn't know that existed. So that's a new one for me.
Yeah, if you get Star Fox Zero now, I don't know if it's going to be a promotion later on, but for now, if you get it for, you know, for $60, you know, normal retail price, you get Star Fox Zero and you get Star Fox Guard. So you're pretty much getting two games for the price of one, which is kind of cool. But I've been playing that. Also, I've been playing Dark Souls 3, which has been so much fun. I haven't really got to. I just beat the third boss the other day.
I thought I was gonna hear frustrating instead of fun.
Oh yeah, I mean it's frustrating, but then again, like you said, man, we're old school guys. You know, Dark Souls is frustrating for someone who's never played Ninja Gaiden. That's the way I look at it. You know, because the thing about the Dark Souls series and Bloodborne, what I really liked about it was, you know, you die a lot in that game, but it's not cheap. You know, when you die in those games, if you had the mindset like, oh, well, I didn't memorize the time signature, or maybe I wasn't strategic when I was battling this boss, maybe I was trying to rush him and try to kill him quickly instead of being defensive, that's where it kind of goes into it.
Yeah, you have to take your time.
Yeah, it's not your standard action game. It's, like I said, it's more of a... It's a lot more old school, and what I like about the Soul series, it does make me think of Castlevania. I'm like, this is like Castlevania, but it's not Castlevania.
I know what you mean.
Yeah, because the exploration and, you know, the upgradable equipment, it's pretty much like a 3D, much harder version of Symphony of the Night. That's what I like about it. But I actually played online a little bit with Dark Souls 3. It was the first time I actually played online with any of those games, because I'm not, like you, I'm not a big online player, and it pisses everyone off, because they're like, hey, let me add you on PS4, and I'm like, okay, you can add me, and I never play with them. I feel so, bad. But, I was playing with a friend of mine. She's a lot further than I am. She actually just texted me earlier. She beat, like, the 10th boss in Dark Souls 3, and she uploaded a video of it. But we played together, and I will say this for people who haven't played online with Dark Souls 3 yet, it's very tedious. Like, apparently, the person that you summon into your world, they have to have, like, some sort of, like, white stone. And you would think, okay, you lay down the white stone, then the person on the other side sees the summon thing, the insignia on the ground, and you can summon them. That's what happens. But the problem is that doesn't always work. So you actually have to continuously drop this stone. It took us like 6 tries, because what it is Dark Souls has like their servers. And if they drop down the stone and you don't see it on your side, you guys are on different servers. So you have to constantly do it to reset, and you have to wait like 10 seconds. But finally got her in the game. She helped me beat the third boss, which was like this big tree monster with, like, pimples all over them, and you had to attack the pimples, and, yeah, it was great. I highly recommend it. It's a lot of fun. I don't know if I'll beat it yet, because, like I said, I'm playing that and Star Fox and having an adult life at the same time, so it's
kinda, yeah,
it's hard.
Definitely understand that. It's cool being, like I always say, it's cool being a grown-up, because you have, you know, you work and you have money and you can buy, you know, everything you want with your money, but still you have to be a grown-up, and it's rarely time to play, man.
Exactly. But, yeah, that's what I've been playing. And before we hop off, I'm going to have you plug your stuff, man. Where can our listeners find your channels and all that stuff?
Well, I have only one channel. It's Karcamo Gaming. I'm sure Xander will put a link in the description, but still, if you're listening, just in case, it's K-A-R-C-A-M-O, Karcamo Gaming. And, give me a second, my nose. Sorry, my nose was running. Okay, Karcamo Gaming on YouTube. I do a lot of things. I do Let's Plays, not that often, but for the most part, when I do a Let's Play, I do it of a game that I actually enjoy, so I can, you know, I want to have a good time. And retro games, right now I'm playing Castlevania Symphony of the Night, but that's not the main thing on my channel. I do a lot of unboxings, like we talk about. I have a lot of subscriptions, because, you know, I guess I have problems. I have, like, I'm subscribed to Arcade Block, horror blog. I'm a big horror fan, especially anything horror related in the 80s. I do unboxings of a lot of collector's edition, for the most part. Like, right now I'm working on a collector's edition for Street Fighter V. It's taking a while because I did that like a month ago, but I've been doing a lot of things combined with that, so that's coming. I'm also doing my first import review about Bishoshu Senshi Sailor Moon. That's PlayStation 1 game. It's going to be awesome because, you know, it's a collab video with Kid Shoryuken, another friend of mine. He has an import channel. Another friend called Jimmy Hapa, he also does import reviews. And a friend here in and also a couple of cosplayers in Panama that they you know, did the whole Sailor Moon cosplay. That's going to be great. That's coming in the next few weeks. But I also do, like, bootlegged reviews. That's what Xander talked about, with a pirate, a puppet. And he's called Neil the Video Game Pirate. You should check it out. I did one for Mortal Kombat, the bootlegged Mortal Kombat games. I did one for the bootlegged Street Fighter games prior to the release of Street Fighter V. I do amiibo hunts, you know, I go out. Oh, by the way, just in case, I mean, I don't think you'll be asking yourself this. until this point of the podcast, but still, you know, I'm a pro wrestler, and my gimmick is that I wear a face paint. So I go everywhere in my amiibo hunts, and I'm with my face paint. Also, I mean, I'm always with my face paint on the unboxings, and, you know, sometimes it's really crazy seeing me like this, and like in, you know, in an everyday occurrence. So yeah, I want to thank again Xander for having me here in the show. I really appreciate it. I'm a big fan of his everything he does. Love your channel, Xander. I'm so grateful you can. You have known so much. And also on my channel, you can also find, I wrestle. So there's a lot of wrestling clips, my full wrestling matches. And well, once again, I would appreciate if you go to Karcamo Gaming and, you know, subscribe and give me your comments too, because, you know, I take suggestions. I try to do new things. And also, if you want to look me up, I'm on Instagram. That's really easy. @Karcamo, just like that. I'm also on Twitter, @Karcamo507. And well, all the links will be in the description. And once again, thank you guys.
Awesome, man. Thank you again, man, for being on the show. It's been a long time coming, man. I've been like, man, I gotta get this guy on the podcast, and it's been a while, but it's been a great pleasure having you on and talking about all sorts of games. And yeah, guys, definitely, I cannot recommend enough to check out Karcamo Gaming on YouTube. Also, I have a YouTube channel as well, as youtube.com/XanderSkullion. And if you guys go on the channel and you guys also look on the right side on featured channels, I have Karcamo on there as well, so you can click that as well. So, I mean, he's going to be everywhere. Karcamo is everywhere.
I try to be.
But as always, guys, thanks for listening, and as always, happy gaming.